Hello everyone, today we discuss about the bone scapula. Now first of all, you should know that which side scapula is actually present in front of yours in the viva. So first of all, the side denomination. Now first of all, the lateral or the glenoid angle is actually present at the lateral side and is large and bears the glenoid cavity. As you can see in the diagram, this is the glenoid cavity. Okay, and the glenoid cavity is actually present at the lateral side. Okay, to form the shoulder zone along with the humerus bone. So remember, whenever you see a scapula, at that time just notice that where is the glenoid cavity. Okay, glenoid cavity should be present at the lateral side. Okay, and that glenoid cavity actually forms the shoulder zone along with the humerus bone. Okay, now next is about the surfaces, the dorsal surface and the costal surface. Now remember, the dorsal surface of the scapula is that surface we actually present at the back side of yours, means facing towards the backward direction. While the costal surface is that surface which actually faces towards your front. So remember, the dorsal surface of the scapula is actually convex and is divided by the triangular spine, as you can see, into the supraspinous and the infraspinous fossa, while the costal surface of the scapula is occupied by the concave subscapular fossa to fit on the convex chest wall. Now remember, if you remember, in the lateral side we were having the glenoid cavity. Okay, now over there we will be having one lateral border, or which is the thickest lateral border. The thickest lateral border of the scapula runs from the glenoid cavity, as you can see, above and inferior angle below. Means it basically runs from the glenoid cavity up to the inferior angle of the scapula. Now next are the features. So by this you can say that this particular scapula in the screen is the right sided scapula, because as you can see the lateral border and the dorsal surface, okay, by all the structures we can say that this is the right sided scapula. Now next are the features of the scapula. First is the surface. Now I told you before only that this particular scapula has two surfaces, the dorsal and the costal surface. First of all, the costal surface of the scapula, or we can say the subscapular fossa, is actually concave and is directed medially and forwards. Now it is basically marked by three longitudinal ridges, and another thick ridge basically adjoins the lateral border. Now this part of the bone is almost rod-like, okay, and it basically acts as a lever for the action of the serratus anterior muscle in the overhead abduction of the arm. Very important thing, okay. Now next is the dorsal surface. Now this surface basically gives attachment to the spine of the scapula, which basically divides the dorsal surface of the scapula into two main fossa. That means the supraspinous fossa and a large infraspinous fossa. So supraspinous fossa is basically smaller and the infraspinous fossa is comparatively larger, as you can see. Now remember, the two fossa are actually connected by the spinoglenoid notch. Remember, spinoglenoid notch basically connects the two fossa, and this notch basically situated lateral to the root of the spine. Okay, now next are the borders of the scapula. We have basically three borders in the scapula. That means the superior border, lateral border and the medial border. Okay, because it somewhat looks like a triangular in structure, right? So it is basically three borders. Now first of all, the superior border of the scapula. Now this border is basically thin and shorter, and near the root of the coracoid process, this superior border actually presents the suprascapular notch, as you can see in the diagram. Means almost near the root of the coracoid process. Over here, as you can see, this is the coracoid process. So over near to this, there will be the scapular notch, or we can say suprascapular notch. Now the lateral border is basically thick, and at the upper end, it presents the infraglenoid tubercle. Now the medial border, is comparatively thinner, and it extends from the superior angle to the inferior angle. Remember, the superior angle is present towards the medial side, while the glenoid angle actually present towards the lateral side. Okay. Now next are the angles of the scapula. Now over here we have again three angles. It is superior angle, inferior angle and the lateral or the glenoid angle. Now first of all, the superior angle. The superior angle is basically present, of course, at towards the medial side and is covered by the trapezius muscle. Now next is the inferior angle. Now this angle is actually covered by the latissimus dorsi, and it moves forwards round the chest when the arm are basically abducted. So when the arms are actually abducted by the help of the serratus anterior and the trapezius and the various of the muscles over there, this particular inferior angle moves forward round the chest wall. Now next is the lateral or the glenoidal angle. Now this angle is basically broad and bears the glenoidal cavity or the fossa. We actually form the shoulder joint along with the humerus bone. And this particular angle and the cavity over here is directed forwards, laterally and slightly upwards. Now next are the processes over here in the scapula. Now over here we have again three processes, that is the spinous process, the acromion process and the coracoid process. Now first of all, the spinous or the spinous process, the spine we can say. Now this spine is actually triangular in structure, triangular plate of the bone with three borders over here and two surfaces. Now over here, this is the spine over here, and this spine, or we can say spinous process of the scapula, has basically three borders and two surfaces. Now this particular spine or the spinous process actually divide the scapula into the dorsal surface of the scapula into supraspinous and the infraspinous fossa. And remember, it's posterior, the spine's posterior border is known as the crest of spine. The posterior border, okay, it has basically three borders, right? Superior border, posterior border and the inferior border. So the posterior border of the spine is known as the crest of spine. Now the crest of spine has upper and the lower lips. Now the acromion process, now this process is basically two borders, medial and the lateral border, and two surfaces, superior and the inferior surfaces, and it also bears one facet for the clavicle. Okay, now next is the coracoid process. Now this process is basically directed forward and slightly laterally, and it is bent and finger like, as you can see, this is somewhat finger like in structure, coracoid process, and it is atavistic type of epiphyses. Now next are the very important attachments of the scapular bone. Now over here, the subscapularis muscle, okay, if you know that the subscapularis muscle is actually a multi-pinnate muscle, okay. Now this multi-pinnate subscapularis muscle arises basically from the medial two-third of the subscapular fossa, okay, as you can see, from the medial two-third of the subscapular fossa. Now the supraspinatus muscle basically arises from the medial two-third of the supraspinous fossa, including the upper surface of the spine. Okay. Now next is the infraspinatus muscle basically arises from the medial two-third of the infraspinous fossa, including the lower surface of the spine. So this is very simple, right? Infraspinatus muscle in the infraspinous fossa, supraspinatus muscle in the supraspinous fossa. Now next is the deltoid muscle. Now remember, deltoid muscle is also a multi-pinnate muscle. Now the deltoid muscle basically arises from the lower border of the crest of the spine. Okay, if you remember, the crest of the spine has basically two lips, right? So in the lower lip, of, because the lower border of the crest of the spine, there is arising of the deltoid muscle. So deltoid muscle basically arises from the lower border of the crest of the spine, and also from the lateral border of the acromion. The acromial fibers are basically multipinnate over here, told you before only. Now next is the trapezius muscle. Now this muscle basically inserted over here into the upper border of the crest of the spine and into the medial border of the acromion process. Now next is the serratus anterior muscle. Now this muscle is basically inserted along the medial border of the costal surface of the scapula. In basic, if you remember, I told you before in my previous video only, that the serratus anterior basically 8 digitations, and 8 digitations basically inserted at the different areas at the medial border of the scapula. So remember, the first digitation of the serratus anterior actually inserted at the superior angle of the root of the spine, then the next two, means second and third digitations, at the medial border, and the rest 5 digitations at the inferior angle of the scapula bone. Okay. Now remember, the long head of the biceps brachii basically arises from the supraglenoid tubercle, and the short head from the lateral part of the tip of the coracoid process. So if you know that the biceps brachii has basically two heads, long head and the short head. So long head from the supraglenoid tubercle and short head from the lateral part of the tip of the coracoid process. Now next is the coracobrachialis muscle. Now this muscle basically arises from the medial part of the tip of the coracoid process. So remember, from the lateral part of the coracoid process, or the tip of the coracoid process, from the lateral part, there is the origin of the short head of biceps brachii, and at end from the medial part there will be origin of the coracobrachialis muscle from the medial part of the tip of the coracoid process. Now next is the pectoralis minor muscle. Now this muscle basically is inserted into the medial border and the superior surface of the coracoid process. Okay, also the long head of the triceps brachii. Now the triceps brachii is basically three heads. Okay, that is the long head, lateral head and the medial head. So here the long head of the triceps brachii arises from the infraglenoid tubercle. The teres minor muscle basically arises from the upper two-thirds of the rough strip on the dorsal surface along the lateral border. And also the teres major muscle arises from the lower one-third of the rough strip on the dorsal aspect of the lateral border of the scapula. The levator scapulae basically inserted along the dorsal aspect of the medial border from the superior angle of the scapula up to the root of the spine of the scapula. Okay. Now the rhomboides minor and major. Rhomboides minor basically inserted into the medial border, dorsal aspect. Remember the medial border of the dorsal surface opposite the root of spine. Okay, and the rhomboides major muscle basically inserted into the medial border of the dorsal surface between the root of the spine and the inferior angle. Now also the inferior belly of omohyoid. Okay, the inferior belly of omohyoid basically arises from the upper border near the suprascapular notch. The margin of the glenoid cavity over here gives attachment to the capsule of the shoulder joint and to the glenoidal labrum. Why? Because over here there is formation of the shoulder joint at the over the lateral surface or the lateral angle of the scapula. Okay, and so there will be ligament and the associated structure over there. Okay, now we'll discuss about the applied aspects of the scapula. Now paralysis of the satis anterior muscle basically causes the winging of the scapula, as you can see in this diagram or photo. Okay, now over here the medial border of the bone scapula becomes unduly prominent and the arm cannot be abducted beyond the 90 degrees. Why? Because if you know, in I told you before in the previous video only, therefore the overhead abduction above the 90 degrees, for the arm, for doing the overhead abduction, there requires two main muscles, that means the satis anterior muscle and the trapezius muscle. But in this case over here, because of the paralysis of the satis anterior muscle, there is a winging of the scapula occurs and the arm cannot be abducted overhead or beyond the 90 degrees. Now also the scaphoid scapula is also one, we can say, developmental anomaly. Now in this the medial border is basically concave. Okay, so this was all about the scapula bone. I hope you understood well. Thank you so much.